This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
How? Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy. Hello, everybody. Welcome to The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio Superstation, founded by your friend, my friend, the man with a million friends, Mr. Bill Bragg, down in Richardson, Texas, hoping, as always, that he is doing okay. Hello, Steve.
Hi, John.
How are you?
Oh, I got lots of questions.
Do you really?
Yes.
Okay.
These are questions that have been baffling me since we've been doing these shows.
All right.
In the opening theme, it says, "We met your children." Whose children is he speaking of?
The children of radio.
Who are, namely, what?
Alfalfa, Spanky, hell, I don't know.
Us? We're the children of radio? Who? All these unanswered questions.
I don't know, Steve.
And when the Three Stooges have the horn going off, I assume it was supposed to be some type of a fizzing sound.
We never heard
the fizzing sound.
Well, Mo was expecting the proper sound effect, but of course with Larry and Curly as sound effects men, what else do you expect?
Yes, they goofed it up.
Yes.
So it should have been some kind
now,
of a fizzing sound.
Had it been
sound.
Ray Erlenborn, Bob Mott, Barney Beck, you would have gotten the proper sound effect
and
at the proper time.
It would have been something like a...
Yeah.
Fizzing sound or something.
Well,
something like that, anyway.
On the old Lights Out show, if they had to do an electric chair and somebody getting fried,
mm-hmm.
they would have bacon sizzling in a pan, put it right by the mic, and that would
mm-hmm.
be a very grotesque a visual you would put in your mind of that. But that's what those early Lights Outs were. They were. That's why they were on after midnight, because they were so graphic.
One final question.
Yes.
Whose Second Symphony from the opening theme?
It could be Beethoven's Second Symphony.
They didn't specify which composer. Many of them had Second Symphonies.
Well, I guess we'll have to write to the Buggles and find out now, won't we?
See, all these baffling questions. 3 years we've been airing this, and I still have these questions in my head. Sometimes I lay awake at night and I can't sleep because these questions are still plaguing me.
I'm so sorry. I really wish I could answer that for you, but I can't. Anyway, why don't we introduce our first program, sir?
Hello, program. How are you?
Address the ball. Hello, ball.
No, our first program today is the Hardy Family. And I don't mean Laurel and.
Yes, right. Let me offer you a Laurel and Hardy handshake. All right, fine.
Actually, we're referring to Andy Hardy, the famed character
from movies. Judge Hardy's Children and everything.
Yes, and that is with Mickey Rooney, of course.
And I believe Lewis Stone plays Judge Hardy. And I'm sorry, I am blanking on the actress that plays the mother. But it's the same cast from the film. from the popular films.
Right.
Of the
now,
40s.
This is the first episode of the series.
There may have been an audition show before that.
Maybe.
I'm not sure on this.
Maybe.
One.
There
I don't
might
have
been.
Information,
right.
But
this was on the Mutual Network, and it's dated January 3rd of 1952.
Okay.
Okay.
And
let's get a hearty spoonful
maybe,
of
maybe
the Hardy family.
Maybe we should a little bit of Tony Basil. Hey, Mickey. Hey, Mickey. Yeah, maybe not. Anyway, folks, just sit back, close your eyes, and remember the Hardy family, the first episode. And that's entitled Junior Executive, and we'll be back at you. Enjoy.
From Hollywood, here's Mickey Rooney, Louis Stone, and Faye Holden in the Hardy family. We're proud to present the Hardy Family, based on the famous Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer motion picture series, which brought delight to millions and reflected the common joys and tribulations of the average American family. And now here are the same great stars in the parts they created on the screen, Louis Stone, Mickey Rooney, and Faye Holden, the Hardy Family!
Judge of the Cobble Court. Life can be pretty hectic and trying at times. That's why I enjoy my home more than a good many people, I imagine. My wife, Emily, is the most understanding woman in the world. And my son, Andrew Hardy, is, well, I'm afraid Andrew defies accurate description. But there's nothing I like better than to come home after a hard day, enjoy a good meal in the company of my family, then turn into a nice soft bed for 8 hours of blissful slumber, broken only by soft, bright morning sounds like this.
James, the alarm clock, wake up.
Yes. I hear it, Emily. Where is the crazy contraption? There we are.
Good morning, dear.
Good morning. Emily, it's pitch black. My watch must have stopped. It says only 5 o'clock.
Oh, James, I do wish you'd get a new watch. Why, it's 5 minutes after 5.
Yes, I guess it should. Emily, 5 o'clock in the morning? Why'd you set the alarm for this hour?
Well, have you forgotten, dear? Andy's starting out today to look for his new job.
Well, Emily, my dear, you'll never find it in the dark.
Oh, well. Well, anyway, I thought we should give him a good send-off.
Well. Look at the sleepyheads. Hope you don't mind my breaking in like this, but gotta get out and hit the ball. Man in business can't fritter his time away in bed.
I think I'll just fritter away another couple of hours, if you don't mind.
Oh, not at all, Dad. Ah, beautiful morning. Ah, smell that fresh air.
Well, I can't smell anything but that night-blooming jasmine.
Andy Hardy, did you get into my good bottle of jasmine cologne?
Mom, just a couple of drops behind my ears.
Andrew, perfume behind your ear. What kind of a job are you looking for?
Dad, there's more to it than just having your shoes shined. An applicant for a job can't look droopy. You ought to smell good, too.
To think that I look for work with just a clean pair of socks.
Gotta make an impression, Dad.
Do you have the company in mind that you're going to work for, Andy?
Mother, the old-fashioned way is for the company to select the employees.
Oh, no, Dad. That era is definitely dead. I'm going to handle this in an intelligent, modern manner.
Well, Andrew, if you'd like a little advice from a man who's old enough to be your father...
Oh, sure, Dad. I've got an open mind.
I've always found that a young man starting out in the world should be grateful for any opportunity. Take any position, no matter how small, and prove something to yourself first.
Dad, if you don't mind my saying it, you're a little long hair.
Well, Andy, your father just had a haircut yesterday.
Emily, long hair is simply an expression in the mode modern manner. Is that right, Andrew?
That's right. No offense, Dad.
Oh, it's all right. I'm open-minded, too. But tell me, just how did you expect to approach this job problem?
Simple. Start from the top. That's the smart thing. Get there and make it while you're young enough to enjoy it.
Well, that's commendable. But a lot of organizations seem to feel that a man should start with a lesser position and sort of grow up with the company.
Not me, Dad. I'd rather start at the top and just remain in a beautiful rut.
This time of the morning.
Take a good look, Polly. Don't you notice something?
Well, you've got that Catawait the Canary look like the first time you kissed me.
Polly, for gosh sakes, that sort of thing is for kids. A man with an important new job doesn't go around kissing girls.
Oh?
But I don't start my job until tomorrow, so pucker up.
Right out here on the front porch.
I kiss on impulse. This morning, I'm loaded with impulses.
Come inside, please.
All right.
Now, what's this about an important new job?
Not a job, Polly, a position.
Oh.
I've just been handed a very responsible position with the Carvel Magnesium Company. Junior executive.
Oh, Andy.
Yes?
Really?
Mm-hmm.
What did your father say?
Oh, I haven't told him yet. He's in court, and I won't see him until lunchtime. That's why I dropped by to see you, Polly. Got a million big things on my mind, urgent business matters, you know. I thought I might relax here for a few minutes. You're a nice, dull, restful sort of girl.
Well, lie down somewhere and go to sleep.
Go to sleep? No, I couldn't sleep with all my worries. Say, Polly, does your father happen to have any pills around here?
Pills?
Yeah, you know, executive-type pills, nerve pills, indigestion pills, any of those things?
No, I don't think so.
Oh.
Daddy's only a minor official with his company, you know.
Oh, fortunate man. I tell you, Polly, I can't take this terrific executive pace. Gotta get out of town for a couple of weeks this year.
But, Andy, you said your new position doesn't start until tomorrow.
Polly, these things are way over your head.
Oh, I don't know, Andrew Hardy. It'll be a struggle, but I think I can manage to follow you.
Seriously, girl, there's something I've got to talk to you about. Sit down here on the davenport beside me.
Goodness, you sound so serious.
Oh, you've got to be brave about this. I don't think I'm going to be able to see you much anymore. We
oh.
move in different spheres. You in your land of girlish make-believe, and I in the upper stratosphere of high finance.
Andy. Move a little closer.
Wall Street is calling me, Polly, and I know you won't stand in the way.
A little closer, Andy.
Well, how can I talk over stocks and bonds? Ticket tape, if
Kiss
you...
Kiss me, Andy.
Tell Shanacon the copper is... This Wall Street is...
There. Now, you were saying, Andy?
Polly, where did you learn to handle big businessmen like that?
Well, Andrew, it's nice of you to come and have lunch with me.
Dad, I've got a position.
Well, now, I guess this is an occasion. Sit down, son.
I'm a junior executive with the Carvel Magnesium Company. Big outfit, you know, $1 million a year.
Well, that's fine. But I didn't think they'd pay you that much to start.
Oh, Dad, that's what they make.
Oh, God.
It'll probably take me several years to work up to a figure like that, I figure.
Well, Carvel Magnesium Company. That's
right.
Well, that's one of the most promising new organizations.
Yeah.
Andrew, what is that awful piece of chewed up leather hanging out of your mouth?
Huh? Oh, it's a cigar, Dad, junior executive size.
Oh, see, I suppose that's the proper thing. I wouldn't really know.
Oh, it's the right thing. You care for one?
No. No, thanks. Tell me, do they come all limp and soggy like that?
No, you work them into this condition, you see. An executive never has time to light a cigar, then.
Well, it's amazing how much you know about those things, son. Are they nice people at the Magnificent Company?
I don't really know. I got the position over the telephone.
You mean that you just called up and they gave you a junior executive's position?
Yeah, they told me I'd have to wait 3 days for a personal interview, so I just called them up.
Well, that's amazing.
Not at all. Simple business psychology. But what I really dropped in for, Dad, was to have a little man-to-man talk about money matters.
Well, Andrew, man-to-man, I don't think I can spare any today.
Huh? Oh, wait, I don't mean that. I want to discuss giving
you some money.
Well, man to man, that's the kind of a man to man talk I like.
Yes, I plan to contribute to the house from now on, so I'd kind of like to see how you split up the loot.
The loot?
Yeah, I'd like a breakdown on the family budget.
I see. Well, I got the books on the house right here in my desk drawer. Yeah, here we are. Household accounts and budget for the current year.
I figure on my income after deducting expenses incurred in running my own affairs, of course. Contributions and things. I'll be giving you at least, $5 a week.
$5 a week?
Yes.
I wonder what we do with all that money.
Oh, Dad, if there's any left over, just put it in the retirement fund for yourself. I'd like it that way, Dad.
Well, that's mighty thoughtful of you, Andrew. It's nice to have that kind of security. Now, let's see how we'll spread this $5 of yours around. Food budget for this month is $120. Mm-hmm. We'll put a dollar of your money toward that.
$120? Dad, mm-hmm. We're going to have to cut down on this expensive eating.
Yes, well, I don't think we can quite cut it down to a dollar. Now, what did you say to a dollar toward clothing?
Dad, how are you going to dress anybody on a dollar? Why, that wouldn't even buy Mom a small hat.
My son, you have just learned one of life's most difficult lessons.
Dad, you know, I don't know how you've been doing it all these years. When I think of all the money I've taken from you, why, you must have invested a fortune in me.
Well, Andrew, I never made a whole lot of money. My children, you and Marion, have been my main investments. And you're my fortune.
Gosh, Dad, you and Mom, you're pretty special people.
No, we're pretty ordinary people.
Well, just the same, it's about time I took some of the load off of you. From now on, you can count on me for $6 a week.
James, I think it's just wonderful the way Andy went out on his first day of job hunting and was made vice president of a big amnesia company.
Oh, no, Mother. He's only a junior executive, and it's a magnesium company.
Oh, well, so long as he's happy, that's all that matters.
Yes, and I'm very happy, too. Emily.
Yes, dear?
Do you remember how I was when I was young?
Well, you were a little awkward, but very nice, James.
No, I mean mentally. Was I bright, quick-witted, as smart as the young fellows are today?
Well, I don't know about that, dear, but you dressed nicely. And you always had a good mind, James. Although you were a little slow on some things.
I was?
Yes, you just didn't seem to grasp certain facts.
Good heavens, Emily, what facts?
Well, you just couldn't seem to get it through your head that we were going to get married. Until I practically came right out and told you.
Yes, maybe I was a little stupid at that, Emily.
Oh, no. You got the idea awfully quick, dear.
But I just can't understand how a young fellow these days can make a telephone call and wind up with a junior executive's job.
Oh, now, isn't that a coincidence? Do you know Andy did just that very thing today?
I know, Emily. That's what I'm referring to. You know, my court calendar's clear tomorrow. Now, why don't we take a few hours off and go downtown and drop in and surprise Andrew on his new job?
Oh, I think that'd be wonderful. Oh, he'd be so proud.
Right, fine. I've just got to see what a junior executive does.
Good afternoon, Carvel Magnesium Company. Just a minute, sir. I'll switch you to his office. Go ahead, please. Gee, Myrtle, it certainly is thrilling working at this company.
Oh, don't get excited, kid. You only started yesterday.
Oh, I know, but so many handsome men and lots of big executives and things.
You'll get used to that. Everybody in this place has a title. They give you that instead of money.
No fooling.
Yeah. Take Mr. Franklin. He's a first assistant to the secretary treasurer.
Gee.
He's a bookkeeper. Tomorrow we've got a fellow, Andrew Hardy, coming to work as a junior executive. And he's only the office boy.
Oh, no!
Oh,
will return to the Hardy family, but first, a word from your announcer. And now, back to the Hardy family, starring Mickey Rooney, Louis Stone, and Faye Holden.
Well, Andrew starts to work as a junior executive this morning. Why, it's hard to visualize. I still can't help thinking of him as a very young boy with his feet in the clouds and his head in a whirl over the latest dance craze or souped-up hot rods or some other strange and mysterious thing. But Andy's growing up. Only this morning he said to me,
Dad, a man my age is foolish to waste a lot of time on girls. I should be thinking of women.
It's hard for me to imagine Andy walking into the Carvo Magnesium Company to start his new job.
Pardon me, miss?
Yeah?
Young lady, I'm a junior executive at this company, reporting to my job today. Hardy's the name. Andrew Hardy, where is my office?
Gee, I don't know, Mr. Hardy.
Terrible inefficiency. I'll take care of that.
Yes, sir.
By the by, do you devote yourself exclusively to this organization, or is your mind always on your boyfriend?
Oh, no, sir. I don't have a boyfriend.
Good. I'll take care of that, too. See you later, honey.
Yes, sir, Mr. Hardy.
Boy. Boy, come here a minute.
Were you calling me boy, boy?
Yes. Noticed you bothering that secretary over there. Bad, very bad policy.
Yeah, but good, very good secretary.
Just what is your position with this company?
Well, I'm in charge of office details, the paper clips and things.
Got in through a relative, huh?
Who are you?
Son, I'm starting a very responsible job here today.
Oh, huh. Pardon me. I'm sorry, I didn't know.
That's all right. Whose office is that over there?
Mr. Jordan's, third vice president.
Oh.
Been with the company 26 years.
26 years, and only third vice president, huh? No wonder, he's never in his office. I'll move in and you find him a new office, huh?
Yes, sir.
Oh, young lady, step into my office, please.
Oh, can I bring my notebook?
Yes, and it wouldn't hurt to bring a pencil, too.
I'm ready, sir.
Ah, good. Come in. Take a memorandum to all secretaries. From now on, all secretaries will report to me every evening before going home.
And all secretaries. The desk is ringing, sir.
Interruptions, always interruptions. I'll take it. My gosh, 5 telephones. No wonder this guy Jordan never's got anywhere. He spent all his time collecting phones.
It's the one on the end.
I know. Hello? Mr. Hardy speaking. Who? Washington calling collect? Then refuse it. This company can't afford to waste money on long-distance calls like that.
Mr. Hardy, that may have been one of our representatives in Washington.
Well, he's on salary. Let him drop the nickel on his end. My girl, there's going to be a lot of changes around here very soon.
Hardy! Where's this Hardy?
I'm Hardy. Can I be of service, sir?
Yes, you can get out of this office immediately.
Now, just a minute, old man. Let's not have a scene. This is a business office, if you care to...
I know that, and it's my office.
Well,
Hardy, who in the name of thunder are you, and what are you doing in my office?
Mr. Jordan, I'm the new junior executive here. I know it's a hard blow to you, but I'm afraid you're being pushed aside to make way for new blood.
There'll be new blood around here, all right, and it'll be yours. Lenny!
Oh, yes, Mr. Jordan, you screamed? You called?
Do you know this fellow Hardy?
Oh, yes, Mr. Jordan. He was hired yesterday over the phone.
Yes.
He's the new junior executive office boy.
This must have been some mistake.
You bet there is. Get him out of here and put him with the carbon paper and pencil sharpeners.
What?
Yes, sir. Come along, Mr. Hardy.
Oh, wait a minute.
Office boy, sharpen this pencil, please.
Yes, ma'am, but I just sharpened it.
Well, I just dotted an I with it. I don't like dull pencils.
Yes, ma'am.
Office boy, where's that cup of water you were bringing me?
Yes, sir. Here it is, sir. What would you like me to do with it?
Drown yourself in it.
Wait a minute. Look, I don't have to take all this for $15 a week.
No. You can quit any time.
No, I can't do that. I, I told too many. I just can't.
Oh, listen, everybody, listen to this. The family of one of our more prominent junior executives has dropped in to pay a call on him. They're in the lobby.
Well, who is it, Myrtle?
Judge and Mrs. James Hardy and Miss Polly Benedict.
Oh, no. Send them away. Tell them I was called out of town unexpectedly.
Oh, huh? Not at all. Show them in, Myrtle.
Wait a minute.
We can't keep the family of one of our top men waiting.
Please, I don't care for myself, but you can't embarrass my family like that.
Have you been telling little white lies to the folks?
Been telling great big fat purple ones.
Well, calm down, Hardy. Relax. We'll all go along with you. We won't give anything away.
You won't? Gosh, would you do that?
Absolutely.
I'll never forget it. Oh, here they come now. Hello, Mom. Dad?
Andrew?
Polly?
Oh, Andy, we just couldn't resist dropping in for a minute.
Well, son, it's good to see you with a big, responsible organization like this. You must be getting quite a kick out of it.
You should only know the kicks I've been getting. Well, Polly, it's nice of you to drop around, too, dear.
Oh, I'm so proud of you, Andy. You've just got junior executive written all over you.
Andrew, isn't this young man one of your associates?
Huh? Oh, yeah. Mr. Lenny Barton, I'd like you to meet my mother and father, Judge, and Mrs. Hardy, Lenny.
Oh, how do you do?
Very glad to know you.
Well, it certainly was nice of you to drop around, folks.
Mr. Hardy.
Yes, son?
Isn't there another member of your family?
Hmm?
Andy, I think Mr. Barton means Polly here.
Oh, well, now how would you like to go outside?
Mr. Hardy.
Yes, Barton?
I'd love to meet the young lady.
Yes, I know. Well, folks, how about going outside?
Mr. Hardy, have you seen the office boy around here lately?
Lenny Barton, this is Miss Polly Benedict.
Well, hello.
Well, Andy, we only drop in for a minute. I know you must have a million important executive things to do.
Yes, we just dropped in to wish you good luck, son.
Well, don't go so soon, Dad. I'd ask you to go into my office, except for some men that are in there fixing it up, redecorating, you know.
Yes, you should have seen it before Mr. Jordan got here this morning. Oh, it was a mess.
Mr. Jordan? I mean, Bill Jordan?
Yes, sir.
Why, I believe I know him. I think I'll just drop in, say hello.
Dad, wouldn't you rather go outside and wave to him from across the street?
Oh, office boy. Mr. Jordan wants to see you right away.
Office boy? Well, I haven't seen him.
Stop clowning and get in Mr. Jordan's office. He just found out that you ruined a big deal in Washington this morning.
Andy, you're the office boy?
Yes, Mom.
Now, Emily... Emily, there's many a president who was once an office boy.
Oh, really, James? Who?
Let's put it this way. There's many a president who should have been an office boy.
Dad, I didn't know. I was going to tell you later if...
Oh, Andy, I'm afraid we shouldn't have dropped in.
No, Mom, it's all right. I just found out I wasn't as important here as I thought.
Oh.
But, Dad,
Yes, son?
If Mr. Jordan is going to do what I think he's going to do, I may be able to swing a good assault and battery case your way.
In a moment, the Hardy family will return. Now, here again is the Hardy family.
Well, son, you've had your first experience in the world of big business.
The whole thing was a misunderstanding. That's why I resigned. I learned one thing, though. You just can't close big deals over the phone.
Well, I think it was very noble of you to accept the job and go through with it anyway, Andy.
Thanks, Mom. You know, folks, you've been swell about this. You were right, Dad. A man ought to start at the bottom and work his way up.
Well, that's very intelligent reasoning. But I think the most important lesson you learned was humility. And that's a very important factor in deciding a man's career.
I feel like a first-class schmo.
Oh.
Oh, I do.
Well, don't feel too bad. I've been saving a little surprise for you. The Carvel Magnesium Company has been calling for the last several hours.
They have?
Yes. They're very anxious to have you come back. Report the first thing in the morning, Mr. Jordan said.
Now, you see, I guess they realized that things began to hum around there when I started. Why, I'll
Andrew,
have that...
Andrew, now just remember. Humility, my boy.
Oh, sure, Dad. I'll go back tomorrow and sharpen pencils like they've never been sharpened. See you later, folks. I'm going over to Polly and tell her about the good news.
Oh, James, wasn't that sweet of the company to call and ask Andy to come back?
Yes, Emily, but...
Well, I guess they know the value of a young man like Andy, even if he is only the office boy.
I guess so, Emily,
I guess they just found they couldn't get along without him.
That's right. Mr. Jordan said that Andrew had the only key to the men's lounge.
Starring Louis Dawn, Mickey Rooney, and Faye Holden, is written by Jack Rubin and Jameson Brewer, based on characters created by Urania Ruberall. Direction is by Thomas A. McAvity. Original music was composed and conducted by Jerry Fielding. Jack McCoy speaking.
This is Fred Foy. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve, right here on Yesterday USA.
And thank you very much, Fred. We're back, ladies and gentlemen. Hope you enjoyed the Hardy family.
And... Oh, dear. Oh, my. That's Hardy. Hardy, har, har.
Pardon me?
Remember? Lippy and Hardy and Hardy, har, har.
No, I don't.
The
cartoon, enlighten me.
The cartoon character of the hyena who wasn't really a laughing hyena. He was a...
No, I don't remember that at all.
That was a Hanna-Barbera one back from the 60s.
Oh, really?
You don't remember that one?
No, not at all. I don't.
Really? Lippy the Lion and Hardy Har Har. Hmm. Mel Blanc did the hyena. Oh, dear. He was always complaining. Instead of being happy and laughing like a hyena should, he was sad.
Okay, no, that's one
I'll have to dig out one of my cartoon collections and show you that one, but the name Hardy, that just stuck into my head, Hardy. Like,
right, okay.
Because we'd call him Hardy for short. He's, oh, Lippy, let's go here. He goes, no, Hardy, I don't think we will.
Huh, okay.
So Hardy, so, oh, I'll have to dig out that one for you then. Hmm. Boy, something you didn't hear about.
No, exactly, yeah, well, Laurel and Hardy had their own cartoons.
Yes.
Which you didn't realize.
No, I didn't realize that. So.
I recently obtained two of those on 16 millimeter, and and I got about 20, almost 30 Abbott and Costello's.
And I don't have any of those, and I'm like excited. And, something to add to my collection.
Abbott and Costello's were kind of neat because Bud did his own voice. It was toward the end of Bud's life. I mean, he was pretty old.
It was in the mid to late 60s there when these things came out.
Well, right. Bud died in 74. But
that was the same year that we lost to the Stooges. That was a very bad year for that kind
of
thing,
Howard,
wasn't it?
Yeah, and Larry, I think, just shortly before Moe.
Mm. And Jack Benny in 74.
Yeah.
That was a very bad year.
That was a bad year, yes.
But we had disco.
A couple years later.
Oh, that was 74. It was the start of that. Yeah.
Well, 74? I don't think it started disco.
I think 76 when I think of it. Yeah, it was really going strong then. It just started getting going in 74 and more in 75 with KC and Sunshine Band came in.
Oh, well, yeah.
Right, mm-hmm. But anyway.
That's the way we like it.
We like it, yeah.
We're, the era that the Glowing Dial represents is much older than disco, so.
Yes.
Anyway, what do we have next, sir? We have another, what do we have next, young man?
We have more Strange Doctor Weird.
You mean that fellow that lives in the house on the other side of the cemetery?
That's the one.
He's always home.
That's right.
Played by, of course, Maurice Tarplin, the Mysterious Traveler. Most of these episodes are shortened versions of Mysterious Traveler stories. They had the same writer,
mm-hmm.
Bob Arthur. And Bob Arthur and David Kogan, who did the writing and things for the Mysterious Traveler. And we got to meet David Kogan, I think it was, wasn't it? At
yes.
the first Friends of Old Time Radio convention that we went to.
Right.
Back in
96.
Yes, 96. It was. When they were doing, I think they did a Mysterious Traveler recreation.
Yes, they did a recreation of Mysterious Traveler then, right? Absolutely.
Yeah, it was the one with Ralph Bell and Bob Dryden and,
Yes, yes,
and
that was interesting.
Ralph has since left us
not
too long ago, I
ooh,
believe.
I don't recall but... Ooh.
Yeah, and more recently, some other celebrities have passed on. Just recently, I'm blanking on the name. We were just talking about it the other day.
Oh, well.
Anyway, if we remember it, we'll tell you. But right now, let's get ourselves going into the strange.
The episode number 7 is dated December 19th, 1944, and the episode name is The White Pearls of Terror.
Ooh. Oh, sorry. So sit back, close your eyes, and remember the strange Dr. Weird, and we'll be back to say goodbye.
The strange Dr. Weird.
Good evening. Come in, won't you? You seem a bit nervous. Perhaps a story would take your mind off whatever's worrying you. I have one I'm sure you'll like. It takes place on a tiny island in the mystery-haunted South Pacific, and I call it White Pearls of Freedom. And now for my story, White Pearls of Terror. In the small harbor of the tiny island of Barota, a barren, desolate bit of coral lost in the South Pacific, a dilapidated pearling boat rides at anchor. In a trading shack of corrugated iron on the shore, two burly, bearded white men watch a half-breed merchant gather together supplies, listening as they wait to the monotonous beating of a native drum in the darkness outside.
For Pete's sake, Wong, what's that infernal racket anyway?
Honored father sacrifices chicken to turn away anger of the storm god, Captain Blake.
Well, tell him to stop it. It's getting on my nerves.
Take it easy, Blake. We'll be gone in a few minutes. The glass is falling fast, and there is a storm coming up. We're in the typhoon season now, you know.
And I'll be plenty glad to see the last of this rotten speck of coral, believe me. Even though we're leaving with empty pockets, we can't go too soon.
Wong, sorry you'll find no pearls. Another year better, maybe. Here's supplies. $11, please.
All right, pay him, Phelps.
In a moment. Wong, why do you and your father live all alone here on Barota? Don't you ever find it lonely?
Wong, an honored father, never lonely, Mr. Phelps.
You know, Wong, in Tahiti, I met a native who knew you. He told me your mother was Chinese and your father used to be a Tahiti witch doctor.
That is true. You pay now, please.
He told me something else, too. He said the two of you live here because you know a secret pearling bed down the reef.
Oh.
And that even in that stinking back room of yours, you have a leather bag full of the finest white pearls that ever came out of the South Seas.
No, it's not true.
Oh, I think it is. Grab him, Blake.
No, look. Oh,
stand
no.
Still, Wong, or I'll break your arm.
It's not true. Wong, I'm honored, Father. Have no pearls.
Can I say it is true? Oh. And so we're not leaving Barota with empty hands. Before we leave, Wong, you're going to tell us where you keep those pretty white pearls. Oh.
Phelps, I'm going out there and put a bullet through that infernal witch doctor father of Wong's. That drum is driving me crazy.
Oh, stop it, Blake. We got to finish with Wong and get away. There's a storm coming up, and we got to be well offshore when it hits.
All right, then. Make him talk.
A little more pressure on this cord around his forehead.
Oh.
Yeah, well, Wong.
Yes. Wong, go.
Yeah, it's more like it. Where are they?
The cord is behind you. A board is loose.
Take a look, Blake.
Right, you are.
Oh.
There's a
loose board here, all right. And a little leather pouch under it. I've got it.
Bring it here. Let's take a look.
Yeah. Hold out your hand. I'll pour them out. Oh, damn it.
Look. Six white pearls as big as marbles.
Only six. And there should be more.
Where are the rest, Paul?
Oh, no more pieces. Six pearls all.
Wait a minute. I think he's telling the truth. It helps. Listen to that thunder with you. We got to get outside the reefs in a hurry.
All right. I thought there'd be more. But these six will do nicely. They should bring a couple of thousand apiece. In 2 months, we'll be in San Francisco living like kings.
No, too late.
What do you mean?
Huh?
Listen.
The drum. It's getting louder. Listen to it.
Now, it stopped.
And God, the drum has answered. Prayer of honored father for vengeance accepted.
What are you talking about?
Honored father knows you taught your wrongs. In the darkness, he makes prayer to bring punishment. Now he will make sacrifice. Listen.
What was that?
Honored father makes greatest sacrifice to his gods. He gives his own life.
Right.
Now you have pearls, but they bring you only evil. They bring you death, the creeping death that walks with you in life. When you hear the drum, think of the father of Wang and the death.
No, shut him up, will you? Make
death.
Him stop. Shut him up.
Oh, the
Yeah, that's that. Now they're both dead. Come on, we got to get to the boat.
Hey, Phelps.
Huh?
Listen to that wind. It's too late. We can't get away. We can't get away.
Our story will continue in a moment. But first, is there a doctor in the house?
Young man, I am a doctor.
Oh, so you are, Dr. Weird, after a fashion. But can you handle this case?
Well, I cure all cases. Permanently.
Well, here are the facts. The patient is seen frequently in business offices, on street corners, everywhere. His clothes are always neat, impeccably stylish, yet something about him just isn't right. Brief diagnosis shows he's in perfect shape, except for his hat. Gentlemen, this may be your case. Too often, a poorly made, shapeless hat can spoil your whole appearance. Don't take chances. Choose a smart, up-to-the-minute Adam. They're correctly shaped and styled and made of the finest all-fur felt. No wonder men who are tops in the business, sport, and entertainment world wear an Adam. For Adam is tops in hats. So stop in at any Adam store or authorized dealer. There are thousands from coast to coast. And set yourself up in a nice new Adam hat. Now, Dr. Weird.
Now to continue my story, White Pearls of Terror. For 2 days, a typhoon raged over the tiny island of Barota, while Phelps and Blake cowered inside the trading shack that had belonged to the dead half-breed merchant Wong. The wind hurled their boat on the reefs and sank it, blew down most of the palm trees on the island, carried away the storehouse where Wong's provisions had been kept. When at last the wind died and the sun shone again, Blake and Phelps crawled out of the shack. To stare dazedly at a scene of utter desolation.
Phelps, look. The boat's gone. We're stranded here. I tell you, we're stranded here.
Oh, stow it, Blake. There'll be a trading vessel along soon.
Yeah, but suppose there isn't. We'll die here. The grub's all been washed away. The palm trees are down. We'll starve to death. It's the curse. The curse Wong's father put on us. We shouldn't have taken the pearls. We shouldn't have taken them.
I said stow it. Suppose we have to stay here a few months. We got the shack for shelter and we can live on shellfish. We still got the pearls. When we do get away, we'll live like kings.
We'll never get away. We're going to die here. All during the storm, I heard that drum beating, the witch doctor's drum, telling us we're going to die here.
Get a grip on yourself, will you? Wong's dead. And the old witch doctor's dead, too. Their bodies are gone. The sharks have finished them by now. When we are rescued, we only had to say they were killed in a storm. And we'll be in the clear. We'll be all right.
No. Now the drum. I heard it beating. We'll never get away. We're going to die.
This'll shut you up. Oh, yeah. I say we're going to be all right.
The days became weeks, and the weeks became months. Blake and Phelps lived on shellfish and coconuts and drank rainwater. Day after day, they scanned the horizon, a sign of a rescue ship. And day after day, Blake's despair mounted.
Blake, come on, get up. Your turn to go down to the beach and dig clams and keep an eye out for a ship.
No, it's no use.
We're never going to be rescued.
We may be rescued today. Come on now, turn out.
I tell you, we're going to stay here forever. We're going to die here.
We're still alive, ain't we?
Alive. Nothing to eat but clams and crabs and coconuts. I'd rather be dead. You hear me? I'd rather be dead.
I tell you, we're going to be rescued. Maybe today, maybe tomorrow. Listen. Did you hear that?
No. I didn't hear anything.
There it goes again. Don't you understand? It's a ship. We're as good as rescued right now.
I didn't hear anything except the drum. The old witch doctor's drum. Beating again, just like it did that night.
Blake, get hold of yourself. Come on. I'll prove that was a ship we heard. Here, come on down to the shore.
The drum. I can hear the drum.
Look. Look, Blake. A British gunboat off the reefs. And a ship's boat heading for the shore. We're saved.
No, it's too late. The drum. He said when we heard the drum to remember his vengeance. The creeping death.
Blake, get hold of yourself, will you? They see us. They're calling us. Oh, we're saved. And we got the pearls. In a month, we'll be in San Francisco living like kings.
No, it's too late. The drum is beating. It's bewitching the pearls. We haven't got any pearls anymore. They've stuck to your face now. Little round pearls, two of them, three of them. They're stuck to your face.
No, I tell you, there's no drums beating. It's just your mind. It's a...
There. Now you hear it too, don't you?
No, but on your face. Two little white spots. Silvery white spots.
Yes, they're the pearls that have been bewitched. The drum. You listen to it?
Go on, Blake. Oh, silvery spots.
The drum. It won't stop.
Blake, we've been on this island almost a year. Living in that stinking little shack where Wong and his father lived. Eating out of their dishes. Sleeping in their blankets.
Yeah, it's louder and louder.
No, I know why Wong and his father lived here all alone. They didn't want anyone to know. That's what the marks on our face mean. The creeping death.
The drum. It says that we're never going to get away. That we're going to die here.
Yes, you're right. We are going to die here someday. Because now nobody's ever going to take us off the island. Wong and his father were lepers. And now we're lepers too. Since we've been on this island, we've both become lepers.
Well, how do you feel now? Perhaps what you really need to steady your nerves is a nice trip. A voyage to the South Sea. You could stop at Barota and meet Phelps and Blake. Yes, they're still living there, quite alone. They'd welcome a little company and... Oh, you're going? We'll drop in again soon. I'm always home. Just look for the house on the other side of the cemetery. The house of Dr. Weir.
Hi, I'm singer Betty Johnson, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts Big John and Steve here on Yesterday USA.
And thank you very much, Betty. We are back, folks. Big John and Steve with you here. Hope you enjoyed this change, Dr. Weird.
Oh, air date on that was 12/1944.
Yes.
In case I didn't give it, I wasn't sure.
Okay, I'm glad you did. Anyway, folks, we got a few minutes extra here, so what we're going to do... pardon me, what was that? That was me boo-booing. Yeah.
Just like Tarplin did, huh?
Yes. Yeah. What we're going to do here is, this is a Jack Benny record, a 78. He put out a series of these, I think they were in the 40s, on Top 10 Records. Just little sketches, originally done on the Benny programs, but I think they did these specially for the recordings. This one is called A Letter from Mary's Mother. So we're just going to present that to you, and then we'll come back and give the addresses. So enjoy that.
Gentlemen, as we look in on Jack Benny and Mary Livingston, Mary is opening a letter she has just received.
Who's the letter from, Mary?
Wait till I open it, Jack. Oh, look, it's from Mama.
Really? And what does the worst years of your father's life have to say?
I'll read it.
Good.
My darling daughter, Mary, it certainly was exciting when you and Jack spent those few days with us on your last trip back east. It's too bad you had to dress in such a hurry that last morning to catch the train.
We barely made it, you know.
I didn't realize how much you'd rush till after you were gone. But don't worry, as I just mailed your toothbrush and Jack's hair. The one with the handle is the toothbrush.
No wonder I was cold on the trip home.
And, Mary, I must tell you about the wonderful time we had in Jersey City last Saturday. Papa's doctor invited our whole family to attend his medical convention, and it was very exciting. Mm. The doctors held a contest, and your sister Babe was voted Miss It Shouldn't Happen To of 1947.
I knew Babe could do it.
Please, Jack, let me finish the letter.
Oh, well, go ahead, kid.
And, Mary, after the convention was over, we drove home, and your sister Babe and her boyfriend were riding in the rumble seat. We hit a bump, and the seat snapped shut.
My goodness.
We worked for hours and couldn't get it open. So we called the minister, and he married him through the keyhole.
Can you imagine that?
Your cousin Bobby blew rice at him through a straw.
Well, so Babe got married. Who's the lucky guy? That slap-happy prize fighter she used to go with? Merck?
No. It's another fella. She couldn't stand that prize fighter any longer.
Why? What happened?
Well, they'd be sitting in the living room, and every time the phone rang, he'd jump up, shake hands, and give her a right hook to the jaw.
Oh, well, I don't blame her. Go on with Mama's letter, Mary.
Mary, dear, last Saturday night you missed a lot of fun because Pop and I went to a big formal affair. Aunt Bertha's silver wedding.
Gee, has your Aunt Bertha been married 25 years?
No, 25 times. Now, Jack, don't interrupt anymore.
Okay, okay.
And Mary, speaking of Aunt Bertha, do you remember little Harold who was the ring bearer at her first wedding?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's who she's married to now.
Well, what do you know?
No other news, Mary, except some neighborhood gossip that will really surprise you. Guess who murdered his wife this morning? We'll close now with love from your mother. Leilani Livingston. We pay track odds.
We pay track odds?
Mama used a business stationery.
Oh. Well, when you answer, send my love to your mother and $2 on Texas Sandman.
And there we go. That was Jack Benny and Mary Livingston in a letter from Mary's mother from Top 10 Records back in, I think, in the 40s. I don't know the exact release date of those things, but anyway, it was kind of interesting. I got a few more of those, which when we have time, we'll put them on. And I think they must have done those around the same time when they had the audience for the actual show, perhaps before or after they would do those. Why don't I turn your mic on?
Oh, yeah, that would help.
Anyway, folks, quickly, the address is email glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at voyager.net. Snail mail address is The Glowing Dial, 1055 Townhouse Lane, Traverse City, Michigan, 49686. The phone number to call us at is 810-774-0112. And the website, of course, as always, is www.glowingdial.com. And enjoy what you find there, and let us hear from you.
So come on down and watch us.
That's it for us, folks. Big John and Steve saying keep a positive thought, keep looking up, think big, and we'll see you on the radio. Until next time, bye-bye.
Yesterday, USA, Superstation.